Hey guys, Rob Andrew here. I am in the studio with my good friend Carlos, and we are doing a video critique for photos that were sent to us by email. You can send submissions to me at least for now 1920 by 1080 to rob@localphotoclasses.com. If you want to see these videos, if you want to get some more tips or critique, you can join our Facebook group called Local Photo Classes as well. So without further ado, we're looking at some images from Carmen Wormington, who sent mostly family photography in. And so we've got a woman and a baby.
Here, you are correct. Rob, it appears to be a woman and a baby.
It's two humans.
Shall we begin with the positives?
Yeah, let's talk about the good stuff first. So, and we'll probably touch on some of these things as we go, but great light, great time of day. Caught a really nice moment with the baby smiling.
Good expression.
I don't know if you're familiar with babies, but if you are, you know that's... the user interface usually isn't as appealing as this.
I have a very limited experience trying to photograph babies, my niece mostly, and they are not super cooperative. So that's one reason why we picked this one, was the really great very natural expression, both mom and baby. I assume that's mom.
I've never captured a baby in this much joy on her face. It's great.
Neither have I. I'm not sure I want that challenge.
I probably never will.
Yeah, me neither. And I'm okay with that. Like, I accept that I'll never make a picture like this, probably.
All right. So, but
yeah, lighting good, expression good, good time of day. Compositionally, mom's on the third here. I don't know that she really needs to be, but it works, right?
Yeah, compositionally, the only thing that I was going to point out, I guess we're going past the lighting at this point. It's just beautiful golden hour lighting. It's backlit, but the skin tone, I mean, it's beautifully exposed. So lighting's great. Composition-wise, the one thing that I see is the area around your adult subject's head is like where the mountain comes down to a little valley in the background, and that one thing about it is a little bit distracting to me.
Yeah, so, no, I agree. It's a really awkward tangent. And now that I have a pen tablet, it's right there.
Right.
So I can show it.
It's a little valley.
Highlight that, yeah. So it's just an awkward placement of that. The fact that it converges right on top of mom's head is a tiny bit awkward. It would have been it's a minor nitpick, but it would have been better if the horizon was higher, like that.
Yeah,
a little bit higher. Or even lower, I guess.
So the camera would have to go higher. Now you got all kinds of
I'm all messed up.
Command option Z.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. There we go.
Not to say you couldn't adjust this in Photoshop if you wanted to be crafty.
That's what I was going to say. You could create a little extra piece of background here by sampling some of the other background, right?
It's fully possible. It's not going to be super easy.
No, it'll take some effort. Yeah,
you'd have to isolate your subject a little bit maybe to get it done. But it's possible if you want to show this in your portfolio. And I think if you're looking for family work, you probably want to put this in your portfolio.
Yeah, up front.
It's just near the beginning
because it's a really good, like we were saying at the very beginning, like it's really unusual to get such an expression from an infant.
All right. And then in terms of concept and I guess story, I mean, it's pretty straightforward. The wardrobe's good. I mean, it works with the background and all that. We've got like a red and green combo. It's not a storytelling picture necessarily. It's just a great family picture.
Yeah. Do you think the crop needs to be tighter? I think there's maybe a little too much on the upper border.
Well,
you think?
You know, when you're selling prints, you want some space.
Yeah.
But
just a tiny bit.
I think it could be tighter, a little bit tighter. Yeah. It's not going to hurt it to bring that crop in a little tighter. But yeah, I mean, the tighter you make it, the less appealing it would be as a large wall print. It's just something to think about when you're doing family work. And I think fix the background if you can behind her head. It'll take some effort, but then throw this like front and center in your portfolio somewhere, because it's just such a beautiful expression. People will want to, I mean, I would hire you just based on this picture. Maybe not just this picture. This and a series of other good pictures. Yeah. But it's really...
Also, but you need a baby, though.
Yeah. I'd need to have another baby, but then I would hire you. I'm willing to do that. No, I'm just kidding. I'm not willing to do that.
Yeah,
great work. Just watch for the head placement, you know?
Yep.
That's about it.
Okay. Shall we move along?
Let's move along. Sorry, I keep clicking my pen. I'm a fidgeter. I'm going to put this away.
Let's go. Here.
Child on a road.
Yeah.
So
child on a road. This but is on a trail. An extremely scenic road.
Like a hiking biking trail. Looks like maybe up north.
Nowhere around here for sure, yeah.
No, let's talk about the good stuff first.
Yeah. Well, it's an epic. There's epic scenery back here. Really, really amazing scenery. And then you got this, your subject here, and this line leading us to that scene, to and from, like back and forth.
And he doesn't care any one bit about the scenery.
No.
He's just into his car.
He doesn't. But yeah, that's, that makes, that certainly gave me a second of pause where I was like, well, I'm sure I've seen photos like this before, but not quite with a background this impressive. That's what makes it stand out from all the other, from a typical photo of a kid playing.
Mm-hmm. And I think your framing's really good. So, and the lighting is nice. I mean, it's just normal sort of lighting. It's overcast lighting. It's good, clean lighting. Yeah, and you got a good little moment there. It's a good story. It's a good concept. So, moving on. I mean, we kind of talked about lighting and cameras a little bit already. Not really camera settings per se, but what would we do differently with lighting or camera here? Anything?
No, I don't think so. I mean,
obviously it's natural light.
Yeah. And this part of the sky is clipped, but I don't think that's wrong. I don't think that's bad.
No,
it doesn't pull away from the image at all.
I'm in the camp of like, you go with the skin tones and let the background do what it's going to do.
Yeah.
Unless it's ridiculously blown out or something.
Yeah.
This looks natural for me.
It does. It belongs. I know that a lot of people
would try to balance it.
Yeah, they would. And in doing so, they would be drawing attention away from the subject, which is here, and out to the sky, which is is only the background for the subject and
right.
Not really that important. I know that there's people who get really, really upset if there's any part of their image that clips.
I'm definitely not in that camp.
Yeah,
I don't care either. Yeah.
Where the highlights are so bright that there's no detail there, and there's some people, and there's certain people who will tell you, well, you must have detail in your highlights and your shadows, and I think, no, absolutely, you don't need that. There are plenty of instances where it's appropriate actually to have clipped highlights, and this is one of them. A pretty good illustration of that.
I think so too.
Yeah.
As far as camera settings, I mean, you're fine. The background's slightly out of focus, and again, I think the background's not, it's important to the picture, but it's not nearly as important to your subject, so it's okay that the background's slightly out of focus, or maybe just atmospheric sort of haze, actually. It doesn't really look like.
It could be, because it's got a bit of bluish cast on it. Mm-hmm. Classically, you get that with distance and a little haziness of the atmosphere. So,
right.
No, I think that works, because it just goes to show the distance to that.
And as far as the composition and the sort of framing of the whole thing, I think you did a nice job. Again, you have a little merge with the head where the water is sort of, I don't know, forming a little bit of a line. I don't know if that's wind or if that's just like the shoreline or a sandbar. And then there's some people on it. There's some people on it. No, going below that, actually, toward more above, just above the ear, to the next sandbar. Yeah.
Right there?
Yeah, there's a white line sort of in the water. Like that, one. That one.
It's going through his head?
Yeah, it's going through his head. I mean, there's not a whole lot better places to put his head, though.
No.
Really? I mean, you chose the best spot, I think. I would probably remove the people.
I would, too, yeah. Because they're fairly small, and they wouldn't take a lot of effort to move.
Those will spot healing brush right out.
Yeah.
So I would go ahead and remove them.
Yeah, because they're not adding anything to the picture.
They're not helping the picture. Uh-huh. They're just there.
They're just distracting. So very easy removal.
There's also a stick or something in the foreground bottom right that stands out to me a little bit. Yeah. At first I thought it was a watermark. Like a little signature hiding in there. But it's actually like a stick or something. I think I'd pull that out too. It's just dark, and
it's just its color. It's different from everything else.
Yeah, its color is different from everything
else. Does draw a little attention, I guess. I didn't really think about it that hard.
You could desaturate it a little, or you could just kind of take it out. Why not?
Yeah.
And this one does have a little bit of a story. A bit of a concept, because he's playing with the car on the little lanes.
Shall we?
Yeah, I like it. Let's move on. I think it's very nice. Not a whole lot of changes. Just clean up some little distractions just to take it up to next level. Yeah. Just notch it up a little bit.
Okay, let's go to this one. Let's close out that one.
All right, that looks like La Jolla, California.
Yeah.
As they say.
That's what the locals call it.
Yeah. Oh no, it was the natives that named it that, right?
No, that's Spanish.
Yeah, but you know the I was just gonna drop a Cliff Clavin fake fact onto it. Yeah, La Jolla, as we like to call it.
All right, positives.
All right, positives. I like the depth of field. It's a nice depth of field for a group shot. Some people shy away from opening up the aperture on a group shot, but I think it works nicely here. I like your exposure. This, again, you kind of went with the skin tones, not with the background. Let the background blow out a little bit. I think that's fine.
Yeah, I think so too. I think a lot of other photographers might have tried to split the difference, you know?
Yeah.
Try to set an exposure that will get you the family and the background. I think this is the better choice.
Yeah.
To make the exposure for the family, and even though the exposure is pretty bright on the background and maybe even clipped in some parts, just like the last image, if they are clipped, I don't think it's a problem for this photo.
Not at all. And I'd like, you got the horizon nice and level and straight, which is shout out for doing that, because that's the first thing we usually pick on.
Yeah, it's because it's so noticeable to you and me, and to a lot of people who if you look at a lot of photos, yeah,
you don't want the ocean spilling. Yeah, and it's easy to fix. And so you did a lot of stuff right, and you got nice expression on 4/5 of the family. One kid is a little bit out to lunch.
Yeah.
So.
It's more of a like a school picture sort of smile, where the school photographer has to run through about 200 kids a day.
It's always the boy. It's almost always the boy that's tough, and the dad sometimes. But the dad you can get on board with some coaching. But the boy is always tricky. That's one of the reasons I kind of stopped shooting families entirely, is because the kids sometimes are so tricky, especially the boys.
So this, what do you suggest then?
I don't know if you could have coerced a better smile out of him. One thing that I like to do is...
That you said coerced.
Yeah, but like a lawyer. No, one thing that you could have him do is, instead of looking on camera, is have them... I'm sure you do this already, but have them walk toward you while talking to each other, laughing with each other, holding hands, doing whatever, interacting with one another rather than the camera. Because sometimes getting 5 people on point with a camera is just really hard, and it just doesn't happen. So if it doesn't, then you have a backup with the people kind of looking at each other and smiling, and you might have better luck with that. I will have him walk toward me while holding hands 6 or 7 times at least, and just rattle off a bunch of shots and see if I get one in there somewhere.
What do you think, Rob, about the choice of wardrobe here on the boys, on Dad and the kid on the far right? The fact that it's just that Dad is almost blending here, like these tones.
Yeah, you know, light blues and whites are always tough at the beach on an overcast day.
yeah.
But, I mean, people love to wear white shirts with jeans on the beach for family photos. It's just a long-standing tradition.
Is it?
Yeah. But I mean, at least they're mixed up. At least they're not all matchy-matchy.
Yeah, no, that's a fair point. I just think that, see, like, right along here.
Yeah, definitely you're losing
the tone, just the, yeah, the grays and whites and blues in here are very similar from what's inside of Dad's shirt. So
right.
He's right on the edge here. It's pretty close to him starting to blend.
And there's not a lot you could really do about it besides change the wardrobe.
Well, you think post could bring the shirt back a tiny bit?
I think
not so much that it draws attention, but just enough so that it's clear that Dad is lifted off of the background.
You might be able to bring it back in post, but you're gonna have to select it carefully and all that to make it realistic.
Yeah,
and you don't want to darken the water too much. I don't think, like we said about kind of trying to balance the background, might be not the best choice. So you were kind of dealt that one. And it doesn't bother me too much. It's just a thing to kind of look out for, I guess.
Yeah. And then one minor nitpick here is I would get rid of
the tag on the
tag
shirt.
Right there.
Yeah. That's easy. What stood out to me more than the shirt color itself.
Yeah.
It's just the
that's
tag.
An easy fix. Mm-hmm. Very easily.
Why not? It's a shirt that's
clone
probably,
that out.
Yeah, clone it out. It's designed to be worn tucked in, probably, as you know, most men's shirts are.
Yeah, I think I feel like when you buy a new shirt, you're supposed to, those fancier dress shirts will come with something like that, and you're actually supposed to remove it.
Maybe.
I think.
Man, you might have just bought it for the photo shoot that day. And I'm walking around in like a Slayer t-shirt, and his wife told him to go buy some. That's what I would have done.
Yeah.
So, yeah, other than that.
We cover everything?
I think we covered just about everything. You know, composition is really nice. I think this amount of crop is pretty good. I wouldn't really shoot it any tighter or any wider. The guy's head is kind of on the horizon line, but I don't mind
There's nowhere else to put him.
Yeah, I don't mind it. There's no place else to really put him. And also the horizon is so faint in there anyway. It's not a sharp line that it's fine. Yeah. So with that, let's move on to the next one.
Let's go here. Another family. Another beach? No. Similar?
It's La Jolla.
Is it the same beach?
That's another La Jolla
Could
beach.
It be like just a 180-degree turn looking south instead of north?
See, I said La Jolla that time because I want people to know that I know how to really say it. Because my pride took over.
Yeah. Otherwise, they're going to leave comments.
Yeah. So this one... Well, let's talk about the stuff in order.
Yeah.
So, positives...
Good expression on everybody. Everybody looks happy to be there.
So, you know, he's got the light shirt, but just the weather cooperated more and pops off the background just fine.
Yeah. It's a much cleaner, crisper line.
Yeah. So sometimes it's just the weather.
Yeah. So good expression and good posing, too. Like, everybody looks natural.
Yeah. The posing's really nice. The boy on the left, maybe a little stiff, but pretty natural expressions on everyone. I like the leg poses on the ladies. They look, the ankle cross is like a technique that I show people when we do classes. And the dad kissing the daughter on the cheek, I assume that's her dad, is a nice little interaction.
Yeah.
It makes the photo fun.
Now, do you think, lighting wise, you think they're a little hot though on the side of the face?
I'm okay because
especially mom.
Looks
like mom's forehead, mom's cheek.
She's a little hot. Yeah, I guess highlight recovery maybe on this one.
Yeah, I would do a little bit on the kids' faces there because it's looks like late in the day, right?
It's a late
sun. Afternoon. Yeah, see the long shadow over here.
Late afternoon sun, west sun, and it's a little hot. You could just highlight recovery slider those.
I don't think it's clipped.
Yeah, not a lot, but It's a lively sunlight kind of look. I like it.
Yeah, and if it was my shot, I would want to move. I want to get the family a little bit away from the structures in the background here.
Exactly.
See where we're merging.
Yeah, as far as composition, that's the main thing I saw. Like the head.
So if the family was moved over to the just a couple steps to the right, or the photographer took a couple steps to the left.
In this case, you almost have to move the family, because if you start moving the camera left, you'll be going at an angle more against the sun, I think.
Oh, yeah.
And you start to shoot the shadow side of their faces. So I would maybe either way, move the camera left or move the people right, but I'm erring towards moving the people right if it's my shot.
Yeah. And how about our background action over here?
Yeah, I mean, I guess this is just one of those matter of opinion type of things, right? I mean, there's people there. The one dude's a little distracting. He looks to be shirtless with red shorts on, so he just stands out a little bit.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, once you take him out, do you have to take everyone out?
Oh, and I would, yeah.
We just remove everyone.
I would just take them all out, yeah.
So I think why it's, not? But you think it's all or nothing, or you think you could kind of move the distracting?
I guess you'd have to try it. Yeah, you'd have to clone this one guy out.
And then look at it.
And then look at it and see if you can live with it. But once I see one person cluttering my background, I want to get rid of all of them. So I would just lose all of them.
So you could remove them. I mean, yeah. Sometimes people in the background gives like a little editorial flair, but in this case,
yeah, I don't think it does.
There's not enough of them to really. Mm-hmm. They just kind of look like they're meandering around the rock.
And they're so small in the frame, and yeah, I think it would be a pretty, pretty easy removal to do, right?
Yeah.
It wouldn't be that
difficult. No, they could be removed pretty easily. They're healable, spot healable, I think, or just even content aware might take care of a couple of those. So yeah, you could remove them. They're not bothering me a whole lot, but they are kind of a thing that you look at. And, you know, but it's clean. It's pretty clean. You know, the house is the main thing. Mm-hmm. With the kid's head, that's the main thing I noticed.
Yeah.
All right. So good. Yeah, you're just Carmen. You're just watching people's heads. That's what your homework is: just watch people's heads and try to get them a little bit in a cleaner spot. And if you want to look at Carmen's work, she's called Little Peanut Portraits. I think she's still called that. I saw that mark on a couple pictures. And then we're going to look at, we have a couple snaps from Jess Cassidy. I'm sorry, Jess, we didn't receive all of your photos full size. So these are the ones that I found that were full size. You had a couple other images that you tried to send that came out small. They were a little more documentary. There was people in those. So if you want to send the people shots again, and you can find a way to send them full size or at least HD size, we'd love to review those at some point as well. Don't feel like you can't submit more images because you've submitted once. So this one.
Do you want to look at?
Let's start with the sunset because we had it open already. It's already stuck in my mind. Looks like a fairly basic snapshot. Let's start with the positives. It's done at an interesting time of day. You have color in the sky. You have a reflection in the bottom. If you're looking for reflections and cool skies, that's
accomplished.
That's
the time of day. Yeah,
it's the time of day to do it. And then just moving on. So let's go to composition, and obviously lighting is just a basic kind of silhouette against the sunset. Camera setup looks pretty basic. I don't know if it's a phone or an SLR or what she's.
Well,
the ratio looks
a little off from
unusual?
A 2-3. Yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't look like
so. It could be a 4-5 off a phone.
The type of rectangle is what we're saying. The ratio looks a little different than what you'd see from a camera. A dedicated camera, that is. And it just needs a subject.
Yeah, I think that. Maybe the power lines are the subject question marks, right? Yeah. Because it's their lines leading me to it, and it's on a third
Sure, the way she placed the power, the power line tower thing is on kind of on that third almost. It's not really quite on the dot, but it's
right. And so that's what leads me to believe that's the subject.
Or maybe she was thinking some leading lines thing with the power lines going into the frame, which kind of makes sense. But it's just not the most interesting subject.
Right. Yeah. I don't know how to. I mean, what would you change? How would we improve upon this?
You know, I think you just got to take this time of day, this lighting, this interesting sky, and find a better foreground to go with it.
Yeah. Or find another subject within this lighting.
Right.
Yeah.
Maybe you get close to the edge of that body of water and you get your camera low. There might be something there. I'm not sure where that is. That could be a puddle for all I know.
Yeah.
In the middle of a dangerous, treacherous place to walk. But yeah, it just needs a more interesting subject all around. Yeah, so your homework, Jess, is to go out at that time of day and go find something more interesting to put your camera in front of. So this one, again, it's a little bit just snapshotty. I'm not really sure if the wheelbarrow is what we're supposed to look at.
That's the first thing I see, just because of its placement in the frame and the contrast, right? It's the highest contrast part of the photo, and the way it's placed kind of leads me to think this is what I'm supposed to look at. But yeah, it's not a terribly interesting subject. So I guess, yeah, similar to the other photos, if you're going to come back to the scene, yeah, find something else within this scene and within this lighting.
I'm not sure, Jess, if you've taken our 101 photography 101 class, that might be a good one to review, or maybe you have and you're doing, because it looks like you've done another rule of thirds with the landscape ending at about a third, the brightest area ending at about a third of the frame, which is pretty good rule to follow. However, you again just need a more interesting subject to photograph. So, and the wheelbarrow being in shadow like that, in heavy shadow, kind of I guess diminishes it as a subject. At the same time,
I guess so.
It kind of,
if there had been no shadow on it and it's a wheelbarrow against this really bright foreground, I guess it stands out more. But at the end, it's still a wheelbarrow.
Right.
And not very interesting beyond that.
Right. You've got this post in the foreground, and then you've got the wheelbarrow, and then you've got this empty trailer in the back. So I'm not 100% sure what I'm supposed to be looking at. So you just need to make your subject clearer. Wheelbarrow full of something might be cool. Full of smiling babies, like I saw earlier.
Yeah. Pulls a whole family in there somehow.
Full of flowers, I don't know. And then you're zoomed in tighter on it, maybe something like that. It looks like you're into the kind of black and white look. And I don't know if this was some kind of automatic filter you put on the picture or not.
It looks like it has a tone on it too.
Right? Some kind of
like
tone,
a bluish.
Like a little bluish tone. Carlos is not a fan of toning black and white images.
I'm not, no. I feel like it's, let the picture be in color. Or let it be in black and white. Choose one or the other. The tones, tones have never made sense to me, because the tones are what happens to black and white photos when they age naturally. So if you have an old black and white print and it's decades old, yeah, and starts to tone on its own. There's also ways to do this in a darkroom, but it's obvious that this is done
digitally.
And so I've never been a big fan of it. I'm pretty sure I have never seen a toned photo where I thought, wow, that tone really added a lot to the picture.
When your computer gets really old, they start to tone. If you have a if your monitor gets really, really old, maybe they do start to tone.
Like a really, really old cathode ray tube.
Maybe that'll be the vintage photo filter of the future, where there'll just be a few pixels missing, and there'll be a magenta cast over the whole thing.
Yeah.
And it'll just be like darker on one side. That'll be the toning of the future. No, I think, I agree. Just make it black and white or make it color. And when you're starting out like this, try to make it so we know exactly what we're supposed to look at when we look at your picture. It's got a clear subject, and also try to make it so it can really look, if it doesn't look cool unfiltered, it's probably not going to look that much cooler filtered. Like, you keep applying filters to it and trying to punch it up a notch to make it look good, it's probably not that strong of a photo to begin with. So make sure you have a really strong photo you're starting out with a clear subject and something of interest in the frame, and then start adding a little bit of that post-production.
Right.
But really for beginners, I mean, I recommend...
No post-production
just
beyond cropping
and
a little brightness adjustment.
Straighten the horizon.
Yeah.
Crop it. Adjust the exposure and try to keep your contrast. Like, I don't know, if you're a beginner, don't push that slider past 10. You're not doing anybody any favors.
Yeah. And in particular, the I feel like the most abused slider is clarity.
Saturation.
When you're a beginner.
Saturation's a close second. That's
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, stay away from those. Pull back. The most difficult thing about post-process I've always maintained is restraint.
restraint in the beginning, because you're going to be a better photographer for not doing so much after the fact. You're doing it right in the camera. All right. If you haven't taken Photo 101, take it at localphotoclasses.com for free. All you have to do is sign up as a registered user on the website, and you'll be able to take that class. It tells you a lot about composition lines and things like that that might help you become a better photographer, even if you're a little more advanced. So
I think we're done.
I think we're done with that. Thank you for your submissions. And again, you can email submissions to rob@localphotoclasses.com. See you soon.
Peace.